Good evening. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Judy Woodruff is on assignment on the NewsHour tonight.
I really was not ready or equipped to run for president against a reality TV candidate.
One-on-one with Hillary Clinton, from North Korea to racism, the former presidential candidate tells Judy Woodruff what she thinks are the greatest threats to the nation.
In many ways, the Trump presidency poses a clear and present danger to our country and to the world.
Also ahead this Friday, the voices of the Vietnam War. In the second part of our look at Ken Burns and Lynn Novick's new documentary, how telling the whole story takes all perspectives.
We Americans always assume we're at the center of this story of Vietnam, that the Vietnam War is about Americans.
Right.
And it's Friday. Mark Shields and David Brooks are here to talk Hillary Clinton's election tell-all and President Trump's deal with the Democrats. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour. British police launched a major manhunt after a homemade bomb exploded on a subway train in southwest London. The Islamic State group claimed responsibility, and the British government raised the threat level to critical, meaning another attack could be imminent. Parik O'Brien of Independent Television News has our report.
This is the remains of a device detonated on a packed tube train at 8:20 this morning. The fifth terrorist attack in the UK this year targeted the morning commute, the school run.
Right, guys, let's get away and let's move right down the end of the platform.
29 people were treated in hospital. There were no serious injuries. Two teachers, one stop from work, were near the device as it went off at the back of the train, described a fireball coming at them down the carriage.
I saw the fire merge towards me, my side. So, I heard a lady screaming.
I was falling over people myself, and I was just saying to myself, keep upright, because either you're going to become put to death or you've got a madman behind you, because I still didn't know what was going on.
People described to us a flash of fire suddenly running up the walls of the carriage, burning those nearby. Then the panic.
That moment when people were running towards me and pushing you out of the way, and you're unsure of what's happening, you don't know whether to fight or run, and it was that sort of 10 seconds of sheer panic, and the whole train went through it, and it was just like a tidal wave.
But now what's happening is that I think people are getting crushed on the stairwell.
After the initial surge of people, this was the scene on the crowded platform. People trying to make sense of what had happened. Still partly on fire when these pictures were taken, wires are clearly visible sticking out from the would-be bomb. It's still not known exactly why it failed to fully detonate. It's been reported that some sort of timer device may have been attached to the IED. The official police statement today didn't speak to this point, but emphasized that the search is on for a perpetrator.
President Trump reacted to the attack with a tweet that suggested police could have done more to prevent it. British Prime Minister Theresa May responded by saying, quote, "I never think it's helpful for anybody to speculate on what is an ongoing investigation." Later, the two spoke by phone. The White House said the president's criticism may have come up in the conversation. Mr. Trump voiced confidence today that the U.S. options for dealing with North Korea are, quote, both effective and overwhelming. He spoke after the North Koreans launched another ballistic missile over northern Japan. At the White House, the president's national security advisor, H.R. McMaster, called for rigorous enforcement of sanctions to cripple the North's economy.
What's different about this approach is that we're out of time. We've been kicking the can down the road, and we're out of road. And so for those who have said and have been commenting about the lack of a military option, there is a military option. Now, it's not what we would prefer to do. So what we have to do is call on all nations, call on everyone to do everything we can to address this global problem short of war.
The North's latest missile flight covered 2,300 miles. That would be far enough to reach the U.S. territory of Guam. This afternoon, the U.N. Security Council condemned the launch. A judge in St. Louis has acquitted a white former police officer, Jason Stockley, in a fatal shooting. He was charged in the killing of a black man, Anthony Lamar Smith, after a high-speed chase in 2011. After today's verdict, hundreds of protesters marched, most of them peacefully. A small group confronted police and got pepper sprayed. More glimmers of progress today in the recovery from Hurricane Irma. Utilities in Florida say they've restored power to more than 80% of the homes and businesses that lost it. Even so, nearly 3.5 million people are still in the dark. Meanwhile, local officials report more than 100 sewage overflows caused by the storm. A single spill near Miami spewed about 6 million gallons of wastewater. Chronic hunger around the world is rising again after a decade of decline. The United Nations reports 815 million people went hungry last year, up 38 million from the previous year. 60% were in war zones. The UN also cited floods and drought as causes. NASA's Cassini spacecraft bade a fiery farewell today, burning up in Saturn's atmosphere. Flight controllers destroyed the vehicle to prevent it from crashing into one of two moons that may harbor life. NASA animation showed Cassini's final plunge. It had nearly exhausted its fuel after recording more than 450,000 images and a huge trove of data.
The discoveries that Cassini has made over the past 13 years in orbit have rewritten the textbooks of Saturn, have discovered worlds that could be habitable, and have guaranteed that we will return to that ringed world. So the fantastic discoveries that continue to be made with the last set of ring crossing orbits and in the grand finale of Cassini haven't really even been studied yet.
Cassini was launched in 1997. It's the only spacecraft ever to orbit Saturn. A federal judge in Chicago today blocked the Justice Department from withholding grants for cities that harbor undocumented immigrants. The temporary injunction applies nationwide to so-called sanctuary cities that refuse to cooperate with federal immigration agents. Chicago is one of at least seven cities and counties that have balked at enforcing tougher immigration rules. On Wall Street, the Dow Jones Industrial Average gained more than 64 points to close at 22,268. The NASDAQ rose 19 points, and the S&P 500 added 4, hitting 2,500 for the first time. And something new at the White House today, an 11-year-old boy mowing the lawn. Frank Giaccio of Falls Church, Virginia, got the gig after offering his services to President Trump. This morning, he cut the rose garden grass, and he kept his focus even when the president walked alongside him. Mr. Trump called him the future of the country. The boy said he usually charges $8 a lawn, but he did the White House job for free. Still to come on the NewsHour, Judy Woodruff's interview with Hillary Clinton about her new book and the Trump presidency. Mark Shields and David Brooks' take on the week's news. Preserving voices from Vietnam, the newest Ken Burns documentary, The Vietnam War, and much more. Hillary Clinton, she is one of the most prominent and polarizing figures in modern American history. This week, she is back in the spotlight promoting a new book. She opens up tonight to Judy Woodruff, revealing where she gives President Trump credit, but also her fears that he is dangerous for the world. Judy sat down with the former presidential candidates, Secretary of State, and First Lady at the Core Club in New York City, and began by asking about the premise of the book, what happened in the 2016 election.
I really was not ready or equipped to run for president against a reality TV candidate. I take running for president and being president really seriously. It's maybe the toughest job in the world, right? And I knew that there was unfinished business from the successful two terms of President Obama, whom I had served. But that we needed to go further on the economy, on healthcare, and so much else. I really prepared, and I prepared what I wanted to say, how I would defend what I wanted to do. Turned out that was very hard to communicate. It was a time when an empty podium got more broadcast minutes than all of the policies that I was putting forth. And now that there's been a lot of analysis coming from all sorts of independent observers, I think it was clear that the kind of campaign I was running and the seriousness with which I looked at the agenda I wanted to represent and then execute was just out of sync with the anger that a lot of the electorate felt, or the disappointment that another part of the electorate felt. so that my brand of leadership, which is very focused on bringing people together, solving problems, it's what I've always tried to do, just had a hard time being as powerfully compelling in that campaign as I think it has been in previous years for other candidates.
You single out James Comey.
Yes, I do.
The former FBI director. Mm-hmm. My question, though, is he was in the role he was in because the then Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, had pulled back and essentially turned over the leading role in overseeing the FBI, the investigation into your emails, because of that meeting on the airport tarmac with your husband, with former President Bill Clinton. So my question is, to what extent did Loretta Lynch and President Clinton make a costly mistake?
Judy, I just don't buy that. I honestly reject that premise, partly because there's a chain of command in the Justice Department. There's a deputy attorney general. We all now know who it was, Sally Yates, a woman of experience and integrity. We knew at the time, after it was reported, that you know both my husband and Loretta Lynch said they didn't say a word about this. The optics, you know, were not good. I admit that. But in this chain of command, if the attorney general is recused, you know, the deputy attorney general. And what we know happened is that the investigation was getting nowhere. There was nothing to find. And he was in a position of having to accept the evidence that there was no case. I think what he did, against the advice of people around him in the FBI and the Justice Department, was in large measure due to political pressures that he was under from people that he had worked with before in the FBI and outside the FBI. And so when you're a prosecutor or you're an FBI director, if there's no case, there's no case. And instead he had a press conference and really you know, went after not just me, the entire State Department. Okay, that was over on July 5th, right? That, you know, that I thought was a breach of professional ethics and responsibility and a rejection of the protocols within the Justice Department. It was over. And we were doing fine going forward. What really was costly and what I believe was the proximate cause of my defeat was his October 28th letter, which has never been adequately explained or defended, had nothing to do with what happened, you know, months before.
But my point is he wouldn't have been in that position had Loretta Lynch not pulled back after that meeting with President Clinton.
I don't believe that. I mean, he was in a position that was subordinate to the chain of command in the Justice Department. So Loretta Lynch recuses. It's like when Sessions recused. The deputy attorney general steps forward and starts, you know, running the investigation. There were plenty of people who were in that chain of command who were telling him, I'm told, you know, okay, nothing there, end it. And that's not what he did.
You also write about the role of gender,
mm-hmm.
The fact that women are treated differently in politics, held to a higher standard. You quote your friend Sheryl Sandberg talking about how women, the more successful they are, the less they are liked.
Mm-hmm. People all the time say, oh, if you only knew Hillary Clinton the way I know Hillary Clinton. Well, it's really hard to get to know me or any candidate. And I would be asked questions like, well, why are you really running for president? I didn't hear Marco Rubio or Ted Cruz or Bernie Sanders ask that question, as though there was something hidden or so unusual about a woman stepping forward and saying, you know, I think I could be a good president. I hope you'll support me. So I do believe, and in this chapter called On Being a Woman in Politics, that we have to come to grips with the endemic sexism and misogyny. Of course, it's not just in politics. It's in business. We've seen a lot of that coming out of Silicon Valley, and it's in the media. It's in culture. We know that. But in politics in particular, where now some of my former colleagues and friends in the Senate are being attacked, and they're being attacked in very sexist ways. You know, Elizabeth Warren told to, you know, sit down and basically shut up, don't persist. Kamala Harris being attacked. Kirsten Gillibrand talks about being manhandled by fellow members of Congress in the gym. You know, I want to blow this up
so that people have to confront it. And then maybe whoever comes next won't have to face it as much.
The Trump campaign.
Mm-hmm.
You think Trump operatives cooperated, colluded with the Russians in order to prevent you from winning this election. You're a good lawyer. Do you think that meeting in New York last year between a Russian lawyer, Donald Trump Jr., Jared Kushner, was illegal, that laws were broken by that meeting?
I don't know enough about whether that's the case. I mean, this investigation that's going on is necessary and incredibly important because what happened certainly so far proves there was communication between the Trump campaign and Russian representatives, that they've gone to great lengths to try to hide and not disclose. There were meetings like the one you're talking about. There were others as well. Now we know, Russian paid ads that played into the Trump campaign. We now know that some of the placement of ads and the weaponization of information by the Russians was very skillfully injected into our campaign, which suggests that they were getting advice from someone and somewhere. We know that the WikiLeaks drop within 1 hour of the Hollywood Access tape on October 7th was meant to do exactly what it did, divert from Trump's admission on tape that he was a sexual assaulter. So you can add all of this up and you can just say it's all coincidence, but were campaign finance laws broken? Were foreign agency laws broken? Were financial dealings irregular or illegal? We don't yet know, but I have a lot of confidence in the work that is going on in the Senate to delve into these issues, and I have a lot of confidence in Robert Mueller and his investigation to tell us whether there's something there or not. But my point is bigger than that. Let's put what happened to one side. If I had been elected president and the intelligence community came to me and said, well, you won, but Putin was trying to defeat you, even though I won, I would still say we've got to get to the bottom of this. Right now, we don't have any leadership from this White House to try to understand what our principal foreign adversary was doing to interfere with our elections, to, in effect, destabilize our democracy. So I think this should be of interest to any American.
You are very tough in the book and now on President Trump. After the birther issue he raised over President Obama, his campaign rhetoric, and now as president, his comments on Charlottesville, and he repeated some of those yesterday. Do you believe the president is racist?
Here's what I believe. I believe that he has given a lot of encouragement and rhetorical support to the Ku Klux Klan. He accepted the support of David Duke. I believe that he has not condemned the neo-Nazis and the self-proclaimed white supremacists in Charlottesville and other settings. I believe that the Congress had to, on a bipartisan basis, pass a resolution asking that white supremacy be condemned by this president, which he then signed, and we'll wait and see what he does. So I can't tell you what's in his heart, Judy. I don't know. It could be total rank cynical opportunism. He's got a hardcore base that believes these things, and he's going to keep feeding it. He took advantage of some of the conspiracy theories that these people propagate, like birtherism. So I can't tell you what's in his heart. I know that he was sued for racial discrimination in his business. So I think that what's important is that as a leader, he speak up on behalf of the rights of all Americans and the respect we should show for the diversity of our country, which I think is one of our great strengths.
Having said all that, if he is able, as president, to oversee the passage of legislation to protect the Dreamers, these young people who came to this country as children, undocumented, but they came here young, if he's able, if President Trump is able to get that done, something we're seeing movement on in the last few days, he'll deserve credit for that, won't he? Finally,
yes.
After so many presidents tried to do it.
Yes, he will deserve credit. I will be among those giving him credit for it because
memorializing that protection for these 800,000, you know, striving young people in legislation would be a legitimate accomplishment. And that would only come about because of bipartisan support that he would then be able to sign such a bill.
There have been deals, I mean, speaking of the Dreamers, there have been deals cut in the last, what appear to be deals in the last few days between Democratic leaders in Congress and the president, not just on the Dreamers, on the debt, on funding for the hurricane ravaged areas. Why shouldn't Democrats cooperate with this president if it's going to lead to the kind of legislation that Democrats believe in?
Well, I think that we are seeing from the two Democratic leaders, Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi, very skillful negotiations that are leading to positive outcomes that are going to help people, that are part of the broader Democratic agenda. That's what should be happening in Washington. And it's certainly what I would have done had I been president. I would have worked with Republicans if they'd been willing to work with me, and I would look for ways to make that possible. But that doesn't mean it wipes out a lot of the other behavior and rhetoric that we hear coming from the president, which we hope will you know, not continue at the pace it has over the first 9 months of his presidency. But I think to get protection for Dreamers, to save the full faith and credit of the United States by raising the debt limit, all of that is in the interests of America, and it shouldn't be a partisan issue. And I hope that there'll be more of that.
You mentioned the Democratic leaders. Your former New York colleague, the Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, has said he gets Trump. He said they get along. He said we can get deals done. He can successfully work with him. Do you agree?
Well, I think he's showing that he can. And I've had many conversations with Chuck since the election and have, you know, certainly seen him firsthand as a very experienced legislator and someone who, consistent with his principles and values, will see whether there's way to make progress. You know, compromise can't be a dirty word in American politics. There's plenty to argue about. You know, this administration is still talking about ridiculous tax cuts for the wealthiest of the wealthy. That should be resisted with every fiber of our being. But where there might be areas to try to cooperate to get positive results, you know, I think that both Chuck and Nancy have a lot of proven skills in, you know, finding where those are and then trying to, you know, get them passed.
Let me ask you quickly to put your foreign policy hat on.
Yes.
What's your assessment of the Trump national security team?
I don't know what the team is. You fundamentally don't have a team. I think that's one of its biggest deficits. You have a Secretary of State who's largely invisible except for his obsession with cutting the budget of the State Department. You have
Has he reached out to you,
no.
Secretary Tillerson?
I don't know who he's reached out to. He certainly hasn't reached out to me. You have Secretary Mattis, who often acts like both Secretary of Defense and Secretary of State because there's a big void to kill there. You have a White House that has been, you know, in disarray over national security from the very first day. And so many of the people in our government with great expertise, let's take North Korea, which is a very serious threat right now. There were, and maybe still are, a number of people in the State Department who speak the language, understand the history, have studied Kim Jong-un, are ready to be part of a diplomatic offensive. They're not being called upon. So I think that you've got a president who makes diplomatic pronouncements on Twitter, who gives aid and comfort to people like Kim Jong-un and Vladimir Putin, because often what he says is not about them and the threat they pose so much as going after our friends and allies, as, you know, President Trump just did going after South Korea. That makes no sense at all. And he's being played by these dictators in a way that undercuts our credibility and the capacity to come up with a diplomatic solution in that region and other places. So
I'm deeply concerned, and I think in many ways the Trump presidency poses a clear and present danger to our country and to the world.
Well, on North Korea, how dangerous a moment is this? I mean, they flew another missile yesterday or last night over Japan. Do you sense that we could be close to some sort of military action?
Well, Kim Jong-un is certainly being more and more provocative and taunting Japan, as he is doing with these missiles, raises really serious questions for the Japanese government. So here's what I believe. I believe we should have a full court press diplomatic effort. If Trump doesn't want to listen to the experts inside his own government, then go to people outside in think tanks and academia who know about this very complicated region, and particularly North Korea. Make it clear that we will do everything in our power to protect our allies, South Korea and Japan, including installing even more missile defense. Now, the Chinese don't like that, but then the Chinese better be more on board with us in trying to rein in Kim Jong-un. And the Japanese are not for long going to leave their defense against this aggressor in North Korea to us when they can't really rely on Trump's understanding of our promises. That means Japan may well consider rearming even more. That will make the Koreans and the Chinese upset. So we have a lot of cards to play in getting people to work together, as well as protecting our allies. And at the end of the day, there is a military threat that has to be posed. And it should be very clear, if Kim Jong-un attacks our allies or any part of America, including Guam, we will retaliate with devastating force. We don't want to do that. We're not interested in that kind of confrontation. But I don't at least see in any public way an effort by this administration to do what I would be doing right now, and that is China, South Korea, Japan, get them all on the same page and go after what would be ways into influencing Kim Jong-un. Most cards are held by China, but some threats can very well be made by not just us, but South Korea and Japan as well.
Is it frustrating for you not to be able to be in there?
Well, it is frustrating, and it's not just because I'm not there. I don't see enough people who have experience and understanding there being part of the decision making. I haven't seen it. And, you know, you don't have to agree with how I see the world, but you need people who can bring substance to the table, and I don't think there's enough of that.
Finally, you've been saying that you don't plan to run for office again. But you'll be very active in public life.
I'm excited about this next chapter in my life. I think there's a lot to be done. And in the book, I try to sound some alarms, because what happened to me is not sui generis, like, okay, it happened to her, we can move on. Voter suppression will make it more and more difficult. You have a White House commission that was set up under the guise of fraud, which hardly exists anywhere in America, to suppress even more voters. You've got the Russia unanswered questions. You've got sexism and misogyny. And I think the press has to do some soul searching. How can it, in a democracy, and you know, that's really one of the real shining contributions of your program, Judy, in a democracy, if people don't have accurate information, how can they be active citizens? How can they be part of the debate? And if you are facing powerful forces on the right and in this administration who want to create an alternative reality that feeds into their objectives for our country, you more than ever need the press to cut through that and to be as accurate as possible. And so I think all of us have some work to do, because, look, we love this country. I for one, am deeply grateful for the opportunities that I've been given. I think we all have a role to play in making sure it's there for my grandchildren in a way that is just as vigorous, contentious, argumentative, but reality-based, evidence-based, reason-based, which was at the core of who we've been as a democracy for 240 years.
Hillary Clinton. The book is What Happened.
What Happened.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Judy. Good to talk to you.
You'll want to tune in Monday for part two of Judy's interview, where Secretary Clinton cites well-executed voter suppression of African-American voters as a reason she lost Wisconsin. And now it's time for the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That's syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. First off, your reactions to the interview so far?
What I find interesting is I don't pay any attention to books from politicians. And the only time to listen to any politician waxing semi-candid is when they're either over 70 or giving up all hopes of the White House. And I think Mrs. Clinton is not 70 or close to it, I guess, but she's obviously given up all hopes of the White House. And in that sense, there's a lot more candor than I think than I've certainly seen in past books. An admission that every candidate is ultimately responsible for his or her campaign, victory or defeat, and every campaign is inevitably a mirror reflection of the candidate. And she does accept responsibility, but she doesn't do it exclusively. She wants to share it with some in the press, with other forces in our society.
Well, as for the book, it's tough to be reflective and a good storyteller and be in the public sphere. You're so active that you don't have time for reflection. And I read the book, and I thought it was interesting. By political standards, way more interesting. Mm-hmm. I think she's right, as she said in the interview, that it was just not her year. She's not mm-hmm. going to be the anger outsider politician. I think she puts too much emphasis on Comey and all that other stuff, and the Russians in blaming this. But she has cusps of thought throughout the book. For example, at one point she says she really loves the parable of the prodigal son. And she says, I'm so much like the older brother who's the rule follower. Hmm. And of course, then you think, well, Bill Clinton is the ultimate younger brother, the prodigal son.
Yeah.
And she's on the cusp of a really interesting insight about her relationship with him. But she can't. She never takes the next step. Hmm. And I think that's just because active people, I remember I once interviewed Margaret Thatcher, and she was the same way. So much active. Not a writer, not reflective, not getting you the analysis you actually want. But that's just a product of being in the public sphere. I think the book is far more interesting than most political books of that sort.
Yeah. Mark, Obama wrote a very good book, but he wasn't a presidential candidate at the time.
There was a section in there about foreign policy where she kind of slips back into Secretary of State mode. She's mm-hmm. almost, you could see that she's excited to weigh in on this. And she also takes Secretary Tillerson to task. Well, he's never called me. I don't necessarily mm-hmm. know what their foreign policy is.
No, I mean, that was. I mean, it was really a memorable passage in her interview with Judy. What's interesting is Donald Trump, Rex Tillerson, of course, serves at the pleasure or displeasure of Donald Trump. And Donald Trump, unlike anybody else in American history after winning the presidency, made no attempt to reach out. In fact, he's continued to berate her and beat her up at his rallies and continue to have rallies and run against her. So it almost made her toxic to his administration. But I'm surprised that Tillerson, once he got the job, didn't call her and have a sit down. I just think it's part of it. But if you think about it, Donald Trump, once he won, never reached across. I mean, he never met with Jimmy Carter. He never talked to George H.W. Bush. I mean, there was none of that. So I guess Tillerson doesn't surprise me, but, you know, there's no question she's totally disappointed and disenchanted with his stewardship at state. And very frank about the National Security Council and the disarray, the Michael Flynn period, yep. and that McMaster spent the last 7 months trying to get rid of the people that Flynn brought in and had to wait for General Kelly to get there to complete the room.
Yeah, well, she is an institutionalist. And when she was in the Senate, she respected the rules and the standards of the Senate. When she was Secretary of State, she was very much of the building and of the body and going around the world interviewing people. And I generally like institutionalists. I think organizations are really what change history, rarely a random person. But let's face it, this election was about anti-institutionalism. It was about, we don't like the way those things are working in Washington, let's burn the place down. And so it's not surprising the Trump administration is bad at institutions and they're hollowing out all our institutions. They were sort of hired to do that. Hmm. I happen to think that was a mistake, a bad way to run government, but that sort of is what they're hired to do.
There was also a section on race where she weighed in on the divisiveness that she says Trump exacerbates.
Yeah, there's a mixture here. Trump clearly plays identity politics and white identity politics. And race has been a strong factor in this election. There's no question about that. I think it's always necessary to be careful and not say Trump won because of race. I think a lot of the people who voted for Trump voted for him on a million different reasons, a lot of them quite legitimate reasons. And so I think she sometimes in this interview with Judy gets a little close saying he's the KKK candidate. I think that's overly simplistic. Is there a white identity stream running through his thought, which is deeply disturbing? After Charlottesville, we saw that to be the case. But I don't think you want to play this election as, well, white racism won this election. I don't think that's fair.
I disagree to this extent. I thought she put it, she couched it. She said he gives rhetorical encouragement to white supremacists. And I don't think anybody can argue with that. And you know, his revised position number 9 on Charlottesville, that there's bad dudes on both sides. I mean, he just can't. I mean, his didn't know who David Duke was. You know, there's no question that he is the great original sin of America, which has been so prominent in American politics and so central to our presidential experience of the past 60 years, that Donald Trump is an outlier and remains an outlier. I mean, he doesn't see the duty or the responsibility of a president to bring together the country racially. And I think she's legitimate that, and certainly his language has been loose.
You know, there's a pivot we'll make in the conversation where she actually gives credit to Donald Trump on the sort of the DACA conversation, the immigration conversation that's now happening with Democrats. For what seems to be the second time in a month now, Trump has sided with Democrats, much to the chagrin of Republicans.
Yeah. So all my life I've been waiting for a president who would go with the Democrats when the merits of the argument on their side and go with the Republicans when the merits are on their side. And now finally it turns out to be Donald Trump who's doing this. So, oh well. You know, so I guess I think two things. I think one, this particular deal, if it is a deal, is a good deal. And I think most of the country, only 12% of the country, thinks that DACA people should be sent out of the country. It's a pretty popular position to want to some way codify their position in this country. And the wall is a stupid idea. I don't think Donald Trump actually believes that we should build a wall with Mexico. And so if that's the deal, that's a good deal on the merits. Can Donald Trump continue to be a bipartisan president? Well, I wish we had a skilled political operator who could do that. I don't think Donald Trump is that skilled political operator. It takes great skill to go with one party and then go with another. And I fear what he's going to end up doing is isolating himself, the distrust of both parties, isolating himself from his administration, which is pretty down the line conservative, and discrediting bipartisanship along the way. So if we were going to have an independent president, which is something I think we need, I wish it was somebody a little more politically skilled.
Does the president deserve credit, Mark?
Yes, he does deserve credit. You know, when I talk about motives, but if in fact 700,000 Americans can come out from the shadows and not be at the whim or the cruel caprice of a brutal employer who wants to expose them, or some you know, personal enemy who or some sheriff who's looking for headlines. Yes, I mean, that is good. That is good for America. I agree with David. The numbers, Americans are overwhelmingly in favor. I mean, you're talking about misanthropes in the single percentage numbers of people who really want to punish and send back kids who were brought here at the age of 3 and have grown up and are working here. But I think what I find most fascinating to me is Cleveland Indians have been on a 22-game winning streak, and Donald Trump has been in an uninterrupted losing streak since January. And when you're in a losing streak, you change the lineup, you change the batting order. He changed teams. I mean, he just said, this Republican team, I'm going to work with Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi. It'll last about the extent of most his relationships have a very short shelf life, and political relationships anyway. I think, but yes, if this, it does achieve that, we're a long way from getting there, and the Republican leadership and the Republican membership in the House and the Senate have their feelings hurt, have more than that, they've had their prestige undermined, their power sabotaged by the president doing this.
Trump is going to go so far left, he's going to be filling in for Mark on his weeks off. We're going to go all the way over the other side.
The seat is open here anytime he wants. But, you know, speaking of, continuing with that sort of sports analogy, what does this do to his diehard fans, the ones that show up in the middle of winter?
Yeah, I think the evidence so far is that it doesn't really hurt him. There's some of the diehard fans, like Ann Coulter, are upset. And there are a lot of people who are burning their MAGA hats, the Make America Great Again hats, because they're upset. But if you look at the Sean Hannitys and those people, and a lot of the people are calling into the Rush Limbaugh show, they want to drain the swamp, and they don't like Mitch McConnell very much. And if he goes against Mitch McConnell and he changes things up in Washington, so far the evidence is they're willing to stick with Trump and not really walk away from him.
Mark?
Yeah, no, I mean, among the Republican voters who supported him in the primaries in 2016, three out of five of them thought that immigration has weakened the country. But among Republicans at large, those who didn't support him, three out of five believe that immigration has strengthened the country. And overwhelmingly, that is the case. And I do think that he has great political insights. And he said, when I stood at Fifth Avenue and shot somebody at high noon, people wouldn't leave me. And he does. He has a very loyal constituency. And I don't think it hinges on this issue by any means. He's going to have to come away with something. And what could kill this in the House is the Republicans in the House have never passed immigration reform at any time because they could not get a majority of the majority. So they're going to have to come up with something that's tough, whether it's a wall or, you know, mm-hmm. bamboo shoots under the fingernails of people who, you know, come in illegally or something, and which may be a deal killer for the Democrats. I mean, so that has been the case in the past, and I fear that we're a long way from this being signed into law.
All right. Mark Shields, David Brooks, thank you both.
Thank you.
Let's turn our attention again to the Vietnam War, Ken Burns and Lynn Novick's latest landmark documentary. The 18-hour film begins on Sunday night. Judy Woodruff sat down with the co-directors to discuss how history shows the war was actually a long time in the making.
We've reconciled with Vietnam, but we haven't reconciled with ourselves. The news flash is also they haven't reconciled with themselves.
By talking firsthand to North Vietnamese soldiers and civilians, Viet Cong guerrillas, and South Vietnamese civilians, soldiers, diplomats, the filmmakers hope to fill out the picture of what was happening in Vietnam and the U.S.
I've been to Hanoi, so I've seen some of the, you know, remembrances of the war, but they don't have anything like this.
It would stretch to the Capitol building if they did this.
The Burns-Novick team spent a decade talking to hundreds of veterans from both sides of the bloody conflict, in which more than 3.5 million people may have died. Estimates are about 58,000 American military deaths, and the rest Vietnamese, Cambodians, and Laotians.
We Americans always assume we're at the center of this story of Vietnam, that the Vietnam War is about Americans.
Right.
The first episode looks at how, after one long and brutal war with the French, Vietnamese revolutionaries led by Ho Chi Minh ended nearly a century of French colonial occupation. With the Cold War intensifying, Vietnam is divided into two at Geneva. Communists in the north aim to reunify the country, while America supports Ngo Dinh Diem's untested regime in the south.
There is clearly an unknowable aspect to all this. But Lynn, do you come away, do you think, understanding how the United States got pulled into this despite the French being kicked out, essentially, Dien Bien Phu? I mean, the Senator John F. Kennedy saying the Americans don't belong in a land war in Asia, decisions made by Eisenhower not to get involved, and yet the United States was pulled in.
Yes.
Did you understand why at the end?
Well, it is sometimes stunning to think, with all those road maps and signposts saying don't do it, we still did. It seems clear that there's definitely a Cold War context. That's very important. And certain kind of received wisdom, conventional wisdom about that. And that we have to stop communism and containment and that whole idea.
Even so, the film shows that in May of 1964, President Johnson himself expressed misgivings about why the U.S. was at war and Vietnam's value in a phone call with National Security Advisor McGeorge Bundy.
I just stayed awake last night thinking about this thing. The more I think of it, I don't know what in the hell. It looks like me, we're getting into another Korea. It just worries the hell out of me. I don't see what we can ever hope to get out of there with once we're committed. I don't think it's worth fighting for, and I don't think we can get out. And it's just the biggest damn mess.
It is. It's an awful mess.
And I just thought about ordering those kids in there, and what in the hell am I ordering him out there for?
One thing that
is Vietnam worth to me. What is it worth to this country?
Yeah.
Now, of course, if you start running the communists, they may just chase you right into your own kitchen.
Yeah. That's the trouble. And that is what the rest of the that half of the world is going to think if this thing comes apart on us.
Now, when we talk about when did the war start, this year people are talking about the 50th anniversary of the Vietnam War. We're not really sure why. 50th anniversary of what? The Vietnam War did not start in 1967. That was a moment of great kinetic energy in the war. But it started long before that, and you could argue that it really started in 1945.
Which we do in the film, when the OSS parachutes into northern Vietnam to sort of help this ragtag insurgency that they hope will help us against the Japanese, and it happens to be led by a guy named Ho Chi Minh. So all of a sudden, all of the normal stabilized sense of Ho Chi Minh as the leader and the bad guy get challenged, and it's further challenged as you walk down just that path in Vietnam.
Ho Chi Minh, did you come away from this experience understanding better who he was and what he represented? I mean, it's striking. He was, quoting Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson.
During his declaration of Vietnamese independence. He's quoting Thomas Jefferson, and there's an OSS officer standing next to them. So you begin to say, as Lynn is talking about, if you understand the overlay of the Cold War and how we're going to not have World War III, no one wants World War III, so what we're going to do is we're going to pick our little battles and fight it through places like South Vietnam, North Vietnam struggle, that you can misread what a local leader is all about.
The war began to seem like an open pit, one North Vietnamese remembered. The more young people were lost there, the more they sent.
I witnessed Americans dying. They carried away the body and they wept. I witnessed such scenes and thought, Americans, like us Vietnamese, also have a profound sense of humanity. They cared about each other.
One of the things you do so powerfully, which you're talking about here, is bringing to an American audience the Vietnamese view of this, experience of this, the depth to which Vietnam and the Vietnamese people suffered in this war. You make them come alive, become human, the way I don't believe any other vehicle I can think of has done.
We were able, with the really incredible talents of a Vietnamese producer, to communicate to people what we wanted to know, which was the human story of the war, not the big propaganda narrative and the sort of conventional wisdom, but just what was it really like for you and your family? What did you go through?
Even the Vietnamese veterans, we avoided talking about the war. People sing about victory, about liberation. They're wrong. Who won and who lost is not a question. In war, no one wins or loses. There's only destruction. Only those who have never fought like to argue about who won and who lost.
In a big tent way, the film invites voices from every corner and lets viewers judge history, try to resolve some of the nation's unfinished business for themselves.
We made sure there was room for everybody in our film. If you still think we should be fighting the commies there still, you know, there's the representation of that in our film. If you believe that it was wrong from the very beginning, there are people that will represent that point of view. But more importantly, all those shades of gray are able to coexist.
The documentary's 10 episodes will air over the next 2 weeks.
The premiere is this Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central on your PBS station. Karen Walron is a former engineer, an attorney, photographer, and writer. 3 weeks ago, Hurricane Harvey destroyed her home in Houston. She and her family are now living with a friend, figuring out what to do next. Tonight, Walron shares her humble opinion on the best way to help storm victims. In fact, anyone who's facing a crisis.
At first, it wasn't that much, a couple of inches or so. But by the time it was over, we had almost 3 feet of water sitting in our home. My husband and I evacuated our daughter to the safety of a friend's house early on. That's her in the pink raincoat. But when it became apparent that we couldn't save our home, we realized that we needed to get back to our daughter fast. Unfortunately, by that time, most streets had flooded. So that meant wading through chest-deep water for about a mile. As we started on our way, a young woman approached us and told us to wait. There were 3 guys with a boat shuttling people to safety. So we waited. And while we waited, we witnessed people who were using their gifts and their skills to address specific needs in service of others. That young girl, she lived in a second-story apartment nearby, and after watching cars continuing to drive into the dangerous floodwaters, she put on a raincoat, walked out into the storm, and for 2 days waved cars away from the deep water. The 3 young men who took us to our friend had taken their bass boat out of storage and opened their own ferry service to help. And a restaurant owner who showed up to check on his cafe, instead of returning to the security of his home, opened his restaurant to the volunteers, giving them free coffee and water and a place to warm up. Each of these people took a moment to consider what they had to offer and then, without hesitation, simply helped. But they helped with specificity. It's human nature to ask, how can I help when someone is in a difficult situation? It's admittedly something I've said countless times in the past. But the truth is that when people offered, I was in crisis and couldn't even begin to think about what I might need, far less consider what they might have to give. More powerful have been the offers from people who have been specific, like the friend with impeccable organizational skills, who offered to be a single point of contact between us and friends who wanted to donate clothing and tools to help deal with the damage to our house. Or chef friends who have offered us hot meals at the end of long days of mucking out our house. They've taught me that specific is more meaningful than general, every time. People face crises all the time. Heartbreak, grief, and loss, these are facts of life. So I challenge us all, when we're struck by the need to help a friend going through a difficult time, that instead of asking, how can I help, let's mine our own gifts, talents, and skills that we've been entrusted with, and instead declare, I can help you, and here's how.
On the NewsHour online right now, if summer is the season for thrilling beach reads, autumn offers the chance to delve deeply into some thought-provoking books on politics, race, and culture. We share 13 recommendations to put on your fall reading list. That's on our website, pbs.org/newshour. Tune in later tonight for Washington Week with Robert Costa. And also tune in tomorrow for PBS NewsHour Weekend, and we'll be back right here on Monday. That's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Have a great weekend. Thank you and good night.